Hi everyone! My name is Katie. I'm with the Toronto and Region Conservation Authority. And today we are live within the Meadoway. I'm so excited to be here and actually be live within the Meadoway. I know we've been doing a lot of Facebook Lives from our homes, but now we're able to have the opportunity to actually come out to the Meadoway and be a part of this amazing restoration process. So I want to just show you a little bit of what it looks like around me right now. So if you can see, we are right now right in the corridor. You can actually see some of our tractors here working in the fields, which is great. And they've been busy for the last week just working away on different projects. And one thing you might notice is I am holding an umbrella because it is pouring out here. And hopefully we get through without any lightning. But I will be keeping an eye on for that. In case there is lightning, I will have to stop what I'm doing. But for now, it should be a great day of just walking through a little bit of meadow restoration. So some of the things I want to talk about today is really three main pillars. If you think meadow restoration, you might be thinking, you know, it's just a process of putting in wildflowers into the ground and grasses and then watch them come up. There's actually a whole more science to that, actually. And when it comes to meadow restoration, it's three pillars. And so those pillars focus on site preparation, the actual meadow seeding, and then the third pillar is actually adaptive management and monitoring. So those three pillars are what makes meadow restoration. So I'm not going to get too much into that right now, but I do want you to think about what do you think is the most important pillar out of those three. So we have site preparation, we have meadow seeding and native meadow planting, and then we also have adaptive management and monitoring. So three main pillars. So one thing I do also want to mention too is it might be a little slower for me to switch cameras because I will be walking around holding an umbrella. So just keep that in mind as well. But why don't we go for a little bit of a walkabout right now and we'll just see what we can find out there. All right, so let me just switch the camera view. Okay. So right now you see a bunch of tractors working in the field. You've got implements around here, which I'll talk about those later. You've got a tractor in the distance, and you've got this amazing corridor that is going to be transformed into a slew of wildflowers and grasses. It's just going to look amazing. And one thing before we really get going is I really want to talk about a bit on safety of staff and the public walking in and around due to COVID-19. So we've actually set up these signs, and you can see there's another one just down there. There's also a few staff collecting garbage. We'll talk about that shortly. But we've got these signs, and these signs are actually marking our perimeter. And that's just to keep the safety of not only the public, but the safety of our staff. So you see these yellow flags, they say caution on them. Those are all around our site, and they actually act as a border. So one thing that our staff have to make sure is we're always 6 feet apart. We're following all federal and provincial guidelines. And that if you have a question, because I know I have a lot of questions if I see farm practices, you know, going on out in the Meadoway. If you have a question, I would suggest you just raise your hand. And I'll show you the tractor that's out there right now. If you see a tractor out there, flag them down just with your hand. But if I can ask that you don't go any closer than these red flag boundaries, just because we want to respect both the staff in the field and yourself to make sure that everyone's safe due to COVID-19 and respecting boundaries and social distancing. So those tractors will come right over. And if you have any specific questions, they'll be there to answer what those might be. So now on to the fun part. We talk about meadow restoration, but we also talk about a bit of the planning. So we might look at this trail right here. And I don't know how many people are actually from this area or not, but that are on the Facebook Live, but this mown buffer actually serves a very important purpose. So this mown buffer acts as a safety protection for when you're using the trail. So if people are walking up and down the trail, it acts as a way to protect them from getting hit by a bike going by, or maybe it's someone else that's come through walking their dogs. it makes those sight lines are very open and easy to be able to see each other. So that's why we do that buffer. And that buffer is actually a 3.25 meter buffer. And it's a perfect mow buffer that the City of Toronto will come and mow these sections. And then we also run, if you see the homes behind me here, we also run a 5 meter mow buffer around the fence line. And that mown buffer along the fence line is really to make sure that we respect property boundaries of neighboring residents and to make sure that the meadow doesn't grow up right against their fence. And this also allows for almost a walking track of mown grass. So that's an excellent option rather than putting the plant material right up to the fence. It also helps with preventing invasive species. And in a couple weeks, we're going to have a great talk on invasive species, so I won't get too much into it. But when you don't put the meadow right up to the edge of a forest or a property line, you allow species like dog strangling vine not to be able to just move right into the next meadow. And so by mowing that buffer, it helps to keep that separation and it helps to keep the meadow looking clear, which is excellent. Okay, so if we're looking at this process now, I want to bring us back and think a little bit about meadow restoration. And what does that mean? So if we're looking at meadow restoration, we're thinking about those three pillars. What do you think is the most important pillar? Is it site prep? Is it meadow planting and seeding? Or is it adaptive management and monitoring? Well, the most important feature, I think, and many other practitioners think, is site preparation. I can't stress it enough. If you do not put down the base properly and get the land prepped properly, then unfortunately, your site preparation goes out the door. And unfortunately, any meadow that you seed, unfortunately, won't come up very well. So the idea that we try to do is really focus on that first year site preparation. So what we're going to show today is a few of tractors that that we can get to come up nice and close. But first off, I'm going to just hang out and look at the soil a little bit and talk a bit of that site prep. So if you can see, here's a bit of what the turf looks like originally. And then we have our mowed turf. And then we also have the tilled section. So you might be wondering, why do we bother tilling it? Why not just plant the seeds right into it? Well, if you come over here, this is what the hydro corridor used to look like. Very thick. There's not much room for us to see much soil under there, right? And if we're thinking about site prep and preparation, we want to be thinking the first thing we need to do is, if the grass is too long, we need to mow it. And then we need to eventually get into the actual tilling process. So we've got one of our tractors is actually coming. And when they get close enough, we're going to have a close look at some of our mowing equipment. But for right now, we can talk a little bit about the tilling until they arrive. So this section here has freshly been tilled, and we're going to mow, which is mowing that material over there, outside of the buffers, of course. And then we're going to till, which is what you see now. And then we're going to move from there, and we're going to do what we call seeding of a cover crop. And that means we're going to seed oats. And oats are going to grow about 3 to 4 inches, and then we're going to repeat the process. So I'll get more into detail about that. But for now, let's have a look, and you'll be able to see one of our tractors that's actually moving through. And what we have put in the grass before, and I'll go show you, we seeded this last year, all part of site preparation. But what you see right here, all of this is fall rye. And so we actually put fall rye down because we want to make sure that it's helping to enhance the nutrient level in the soil. Plus, we did a lot of our work last winter in preparation. So it might be hard to hear me, but here we have Sarah is on the tractor and she's giving us a low cut. You can see. And that's a three-prong mower. So the reason we do this, so last fall we would have done our very first till, so that's kind of year one. And then after we tilled it last year, we put down all of this fall rye. And actually you can see some staff just picking up garbage there. That's Paul. He's doing a great job making sure that the mower doesn't hit any garbage that might cause it to shred into hundreds of pieces. But you can see all this fall rye that's right here, that was about, I'd say, a foot to a foot and a half tall. You can actually see it over here. And that fall rye, as it started to grow, it protected soil erosion, but it also protected invasive species from pushing through the meadowway. So we tilled it last year just to get things going, and we wanted to remove the turf material that was originally there, the turf grass, and then we planted the fall rye just to hold it over the winter. But this year is when the fun starts getting into it. And this year, you can see some staff over there. This year, we start our mow, till, cover crop, repeat. So we're gonna go and have a closer look at this tractor. It looks like they actually have to, it's perfect timing actually. It looks like they have to come and add some oats with it. And maybe we can even pop over, and we're gonna stay far enough away, make sure we're 6 feet away. But we're just gonna watch this process here. This is actually a broadcast seeder. So we'll stay well far away. They're gonna put the oats in the back of the broadcast seeder. You can see it being poured there. And it's got a mechanism on the bottom that once these two staff are far enough away, they'll activate the mechanism and it will actually start to put down the oats. And that oats will act as that cover crop. And that's all it is to the process. And that's Chris and Drew. And they're part of the meadow restoration team and doing great work out here. And so this tilled section, all of it just freshly tilled, it's gonna get all the oats. Again, oats are just acting as a cover crop. We put it down, not too heavy, but the reason for putting the cover crop down is we wanna know what is hidden in this soil. You might be able to see in here some of this thick soil, and it's a little wet right now, of course, but it's very thick and it's good soil and it's getting all these nutrients put back into it. And what we don't know though is what is the hidden seed that's been lying dormant underneath the turf grass. That's kind of the mystery, that we don't know what is actually growing. And so the reason we do this site prep and repeat that mow-till cover crop and then mow-till cover crop, we'll do that 4 times this year. And the goal of that is really to find out what's hidden in the soil. Is it dog strangling vine, which is a very aggressive invasive species? Is it Canada thistle? Is it some of the other thistles that are invasive? Is it buckthorn? These are all things that we just don't know, and we need to try and find out what is really in the soils. So some good thought process needs to go through this. Each time before we do our next round of tilling, we need to sit and think about what species are coming up. What's the best management for those species? So it's really, really interesting to kind of think about these processes and what goes into it. There's so much planning behind the scenes that, you know, you don't always see, but it's what species are coming up and then how do we manage it? Because our hope for this whole area, you'll see it here, all the way as far as I can see that way and as far as I can see down here, our goal is to make sure that we seed this fall with native wildflowers and grasses. So you can, in a clear day, you could see CN Tower from right here. But all the beige that you see, all the brown that you see all the way down there, that is all gonna be wildflower seeded this fall, which I think is just amazing. So stay tuned for that piece. The next step I wanna do is bring you over to some of our other implementation. So you can see, if you look really closely, you can see Chris walking down to the other tractor. You see how it's running a tiller in the back? It is pretty much the exact same tiller as this one. And it's run, and what it has is tilling blades below it. You can actually see some string that's caught in on the one blade. And it's got some tilling blades below it. And we can set the depth by using the control over here with those two pins. We can set the depth to see exactly the height that we want it to go. And this bar here is called a PTO, and that hooks up to the tractor, and then it mounts right on these pieces on the arms of the tractor, and then away it goes, and it just starts tilling in preparation for the seeding of the oats. And then the other piece of equipment we have just over here, this is called a harrow. So a harrow, I can show you the front of it. This harrow right here, you'll see, attaches to the tractor and we pull it behind. So one of the key processes, one sec, I just dropped my umbrella. One of the key processes is running a harrow over the site after you've seeded it with a cover crop. And the reason we do that, and you might not be able to tell it yet because this is the first pass and it's not dry enough out here, but after we've seed this, the harrow actually pulls up the roots of the vegetation that we don't want to see, and it helps to dry it out. So it'll actually end up drying out the species we don't want to see and then allowing our oats to come up and act as that cover crop. So it's a nice little switch to be able to look after and protect your soil. The other key feature is if you're looking at this open space, part of the planning and the work that we're working on is to protect areas like this for picnics, for people sitting and want to enjoy the meadow. We leave a large amount of sections open so that not all of it is native wildflowers and grasses, but the good majority of it is. And you can see down there, there's another spot where we can get some shade. Some of the trees, most of them haven't been planted by TRCA or City of Toronto or Hydro One. Most of them have just come up over time. So down the line, some of these trees may or may not remain. It just really depends on proximity to the tower, which you can see there, and then proximity to the tree. So if you see some trees cut down, it's mainly because of health and safety concerns, and that people couldn't, there's too much of a risk to the public safety to have those trees being a certain height. So sometimes they'll top them, and other times they'll just leave them. So that kind of gives you a brief overview, but I know I've talked so much about meadow restoration and the safe prep piece. I'm wondering, do people have any questions? And maybe I can take some of those questions now. So let me just have a quick look and see. So someone asked, how long does it take to fully establish plants and be 100% functional? That's a really good question, Soph. So one of the things when you think of meadow restoration, you might think, I put some flowers in and next year I'm going to have a beautiful meadow. I wish that was the case. Unfortunately, it actually takes about 4 years, almost 5 years, to get a fully established meadow. If you want to see what one looks like, if you go to Thompson Memorial Park and you look east, you'll actually see from Thompson to Scarborough Golf Club Road, there's a full meadow that's part of the Meadoway. It's already done. We completed it in 2017, and you'll actually be able to see what a real meadow looks like, and it's up and growing. But the majority of a meadow, that first year is all site prep. Year two, we'll look to seed. So that's what we'll either do, you know, late this year or early next spring. And we'll seed that with native wildflowers and grasses. But then you're not going to see many wildflowers coming up, because it actually takes, surprisingly enough, almost a full year to 2 years to really start to get the wildflowers really coming up. So you might wonder, you know, where are my flowers? It didn't work. It's patience. Patience is definitely the key. You will get black-eyed Susan coming up. You'll start to see some this year in some of the areas that we just seeded, which are closer to the Don River. But it actually takes almost, I'd say, a full year, because all those plants and all those seeds are actually putting all their energy into root production. So all the native grasses and wildflowers that we plant, they're all going into root production and starting to build that energy. Sometimes we'll do an early spring mow, and that actually stimulates the plants and gets it going and thinks, okay, you know, I put enough energy into my roots, I'm going to start really pushing towards getting the energy into my flowers. And you'll find that year three and four, with a quick early spring mow before the birds come back, you'll get a ton of wildflowers that year that will really start to driving. So it's really interesting to see. Some of the other questions, let me just see here. We've got a lot of good ideas, and so I'm probably going to wrap it up there, guys. But one thing to note is that meadow restoration, it's a really exciting piece to the puzzle. Meadow restoration is one of those, we're taking habitat that is fairly, you know, dissolute and not many wildlife and animals and birds using it, that was just mown turf, and we're taking it into an amazing ecosystem that'll be healthy. And you know, some of our results are already showing in a spot where we only recorded one monarch. We did a plot assessment and we actually had 200 monarchs 2 years ago in one exact plot. And the exact same plot the year before, when it was just turf, it only showed one monarch. So I mean, it's mind-blowing what we're finding species-wise that are using these areas. So what I would like to pass along is next week, we have an awesome presentation. It's going to be by Paul Morris. He's going to come in and be in our existing meadow, and he's going to talk about different adaptive management processes when it comes to established meadow. So he's going to walk through and really get into the nitty-gritty, I guess you'd say, of what species are actually there, what's starting to come up, and how are things after the winter, and what birds are using it currently. So that's going to be really exciting. It's next Thursday at about 2 p.m. Stay tuned for that one. And I've really enjoyed my day. This has been so nice to just get out here. And, you know, I know it's raining, but it's just been an excellent time with everyone. And you can see there's the tractors still moving along seeding. And you can see the rest of them in the backdrop there. It's definitely one of my favorite places to be. And I think if you ever get a chance to be in the area, definitely come and check out the Meadoway. 16 kilometers, it's going to turn into just an amazing oasis. So have a great day, everyone, and that's it for now, and we'll talk to you later. Bye.